for another right divided word truth Bible study. Thank God for the review. Thank God for his truth. Thank God for this house, your Cornerstone Church. Thank God that we're not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believe, and we believe tonight. So we walk in the power and the authority of the Holy Ghost. Tonight we're going to start at 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verses 12 through 22.
And the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place to myself for a house of sacrifice. If I shut up heaven that there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and will heal their land. Now mine eyes shall be open and mine ears attent unto the prayer that is made in this place. For now have I chosen and sanctified this house that my name may be there forever, and mine eyes and mine heart shall be there perpetually. And as for thee, if thou wilt walk before me as David thy father walked, and do according to all that I have commanded thee, and shall observe my statutes and my judgments, then will I establish the throne of thy kingdom, according as I have covenanted with David thy father, saying, there shall not fail thee a man to be ruler in Israel. But if ye turn away and forsake my statutes and my commandments, which I have set before you, and shall go and serve other gods and worship them, then will I pluck them up by the roots out of my land which I have given thee, and this house which I have sanctified for my name will I cast out of my sight, and will make it to be a proverb and a byword among all nations. And this house which is high shall be an astonishment to everyone that passes by it, so that he shall say, why have the Lord done this unto this land and unto this house? And it shall be answered, because they forsook the Lord God of their fathers, which brought them forth out of the land of Egypt, and laid hold on other gods, and worshiped them, and served them. Therefore hath he brought all this evil upon them.
So we find here in 2 Chronicles a very often time quoted scripture, especially verse 14, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face. And most often it is quoted by an individual who's trying to stress to others that you better measure up or God's going to make you pay the price. Quite frankly, be honest with y'all, too often I hear this quoted by people who don't live the word, quoting, talking about living a level of godliness that seems to be more than just foreign to them. But that still does not change God's message here. The communication here in the book of 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verses 12 through 22. And so this book records the history of the southern kingdom, which is Judah. And it begins with the reign of Solomon, and it concludes with their Babylonian exile. And there were promises made. There was an agreement with God. And God makes this promise to Solomon here in chapter 7. Now, if you go to chapter 6, Solomon prayed a prayer to God. And you know, when you pray and you are in good and you're in God's will, God hears you. But you have to hear God too. And I think in this instance, certainly God heard Solomon's prayer. God responded. Replied. But Solomon didn't hear God. He could not have heard God. The Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said to him, I've heard thy prayer and have chosen this place to myself for a house of sacrifice. When God ordains a place, when he consecrates a place, he chooses a place, it is for his glory. If I shut up heaven and there be no rain, or if I command locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people. Now, if all of these things happen in the world, if all these things happen in the world, if the sky starts falling, if the earth starts trembling, if all of these terrible things begin to happen, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. So if all the world goes crazy, but my people remain honest, righteous, and holy, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. The promise is made, the protection. God affords us protection. And this is not just written to the Jews. This is written to everyone who will obey God. So here we are, the church, with a spiritual connection, a spiritual relationship with God. And so we're instructed just as well. This is written to all of us, for all of our benefit. We are instructed to do what thus saith the Lord, to live lifestyles that are consistent with the holiness of God. But if we don't, then there's a price to be paid. And so my thought for tonight is the imploding church. The imploding church. When something implodes, it collapses inwardly. It causes something to collapse violently inwardly. It just falls down. You could take a year to build a building, and you can implode it, and in a few seconds, the building's down. Okay, so it takes a long time to build it, but it can come down quick, fast, and in a hurry, and it implodes. And guess what? The people are still in it, and it is imploding. It is collapsing on the people. So when we look at today's church and we complain, well, generally speaking, people complain about the change, right? Oh, church not what it used to be. The preacher's not what they used to be. People say they're saved, not what they used to be. Well, the church is always what it is. It's going to always be what it is because it's God's church. The people of God will always be holy because they're God's people. Any changes that veer from the righteousness of God, those changes are not godly. But God said they would come. It's happened before. Okay, we know the story when Israel disobeyed God. We know what happened to them. Okay, they went into captivity. They suffered. Well, we are no different. Because there is a condition here. If my people, which are called by my name. Now you have to obey God to receive the blessings. If we as the quote unquote church begin to disobey God, then we walk out of the protections of God. Okay, think about this. Paul writes in Galatians, chapter 1, verses 6, 7, 8, and 9. Galatians 1, verses 6, 7, 8, and 9. And it reads, there we go, Galatians 1, verses 6 through 9.
I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another. But there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. For though we, or an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed.
All right, so now here, in this instruction from Apostle Paul, there is a release of responsibility. Okay, for one, Paul is amazed. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ and to another gospel. So first thing is Paul noticed that the people of God have walked out of the ways of God. another gospel, which is not another. The problem is that there are those around who are bringing damnable doctrine. And so they trouble you, and they would pervert the gospel of Christ. But he establishes this, but though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. So now, when you look at the church today and all of these changes and people talking about God told me, God said, our forefathers had it wrong. Y'all know that love to make the older preachers ignorant, right? So they were ignorant, unlearned, stupid men. Everything that they taught us was wrong. Now, here's what's baffling to me. You got where you are saying it was them who taught you. But then you get something, and all of a sudden now they were stupid. So we see the changes in the church. And they make everything that our forefathers, the older preachers taught, and some are still teaching, they're backwards. They're not quite, you know, they can't take you to the promised land. They can't take you any further, see. And so they begin now to attempt to change. You can never change God's truth. We have to acknowledge that. God's truth can never be changed. You can stop obeying it. You can stop believing it. You can stop receiving it. You can stop appreciating it. But guess what? It will never, ever change. But though we are an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again. If any man preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have received, let him be accursed. If you change it, then you are accursed. If you change this way, then you are accursed. It does not matter who you are. Does not matter who your daddy is, who your mom is, who your bishop is, your whomever. If you change this, then you incur the wrath of God. Paul writes in Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, stand fast therefore in the liberty where Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Now understand, I don't care what I preach and teach to you, I don't make you free. Jesus makes you free. So you owe me nothing other than to live holy. That's all I appreciate. You owe me nothing. Which means that if I change and go the opposite from the word of God, then you owe me not following me. Okay? First try to help me. Don't just leave me. If I change, come and help me first. But if I'm just not going to, you know, if you come and say, Pastor, now you know you used to, it's what the Bible says, now you're changing it. Now, you know, if I get all upset and get mad at you and want to get you told and all that stuff, and I keep going the wrong direction, then it's your responsibility to leave me. Mm-hmm. Don't stay there.
That's right.
Understand?
That's
right. Follow me as I follow you. Christ. Don't follow me to hell. All right. So, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free. And be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Now, verse number 7, Galatians 5 and 7.
Ye did run well. Uh-huh. Who did hinder you that ye should not obey the truth?
Now, you did a good job. You were doing good. Now, think about today's church. Everyone testifies of how the church used to be. Hmm. Now, process this, because it's not rocket science, not difficult, it's real simple. If we're constantly talking about how the church used to be, I remember back then. Oh, we stayed all night. Oh, when the mother got up and she got to talking, everybody was quiet. She walked the floor and she put that finger in your face and she told you what thus saith the Lord. And it worked. When we came to church, you were sick, you didn't leave sick. You came messed up, you didn't leave messed up. The children acted better. The marriages were better. All that. Now we talk about that day. But then we turn around and reject everything about that day. Then we come to today. And we toe up. Everybody's toe up. So if, nothing deep about this, it's real simple. It's so simple that a fool can err in it.
That's right.
If the move of God was so mighty back in those days, 60s, 70s, 80s, if it was so mighty back then, and you see where we've changed, and it isn't mighty anymore, and so now we're talking about today is what happened then. doesn't it make sense to go back to do what we were doing then, to reap the benefits of then, instead of trying to walk in the now, because now we've become too stubborn to change, to go back to say, God, forgive us. We've changed, we've gone the wrong direction, and we've messed up. But now we can't get any results. Why? If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven. He'll hear us, he'll heal us, he'll forgive us if we turn from our wicked ways. So whatever wicked ways you're practicing is real simple. You did run well. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth?
Yes.
This persuasion cometh not of him that calleth you. A little leaven, leaveneth the whole lump. A little bit wrong. When you let a little bit of sin in the church, you know what it does? It begins. It begins to grow. See, yeah. Leaven, just a little leaven. You don't need a whole lot of leaven. You put too much, you're going to make a mess of it. Mm-hmm. You put a little bit, right? A little bit of yeast, right? In there, just a little bit. But a little bit of sin in the church makes sin explode in the church.
Yes.
So the point is, you can't have any of it. Well, it's no harm. Stop. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. Just a little bit. Well, it ain't no harm to go, wait a minute, hold on. We're sanctified.
Amen.
From the beginning, well, all my days, and ever since I heard about our church of today, we never went to the movies. We didn't do it. Now, it's okay to go, it's no harm. Really? Listen. If you stood and you testified, I don't go to the movies, I don't go to the club, I don't go to the casino, to the boat, I don't do this, I don't wear this, I don't wear pants, I don't do all of this. And today you do that. If I build again those things which I destroy,
yes.
I make myself a transgressor. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. So there was a reason our ignorant, unlearned, stupid forefathers told us don't go. Because a little leaven, it's good to be ignorant.
Yes, yes.
It's so great to be ignorant. I missed all those ignorant preachers. They just so ignorant. Don't go. Because when you go and all those spirits are there, all you're doing is being infected with spirits, right?
Amen.
We wrestle not against flesh and blood. Okay, so we have a spiritual warfare going on. What reason do I have to constantly expose myself to those spirits? A little leaven. You go to Hollywood Theater and put down $50. You come to church and put $1 in the plate. Right? Now the same Bible says, for where your
treasure,
there will your heart
be also.
So now a little leaven. Well, you gotta have, you know, you gotta have some fun. Well, if you could find it in the Bible, then I could do it. But if Paul writes that my life is hid with
Christ
in God. Say again, my life is hid with
Christ
in
God.
So if my life is hid with Christ in God, you think I'm looking for some fun?
Jesus, no.
Huh? You think I'm looking to take a break?
Mm-mm.
When Jesus said, I must work the work of him that sent me while it is day. When the night cometh, no man can work. All the souls that need to be saved. Did I have time to go sit up on the beach and chill? I need a break. When Jesus and the apostles, they took breaks. They did. They took breaks. They went across the water to get some rest. And the whole time, you write about what happened. God moving. On the way, Jesus walks on the water. Peter walks on the water. He begins to sink. Jesus picks up out of the water, right? When they get, one time they go to the other side, they go take a break. And Jesus wasn't on the boat. When they get, Jesus, did you see all this stuff all these miracles. So they never did take a break, did they?
No.
See, it was always something going on with Jesus. And when they thought they were going to take a break, the people found them. Oh, there they are. Now, how in the world you need me? You have a spiritual need, and I'm somewhere to my, well, I can't deal with you right now. I'm tired. What's more important to us than souls? The most important thing we ever do is win souls, right?
Amen.
So all that we do, we talked tonight in the review about the first of the apostles to be martyred was James. He died for the cause.
Yes.
Most of them died, but most of them were martyred for the cause. They gave their lives for the cause. Now they spent eternity with Jesus in peace. Here we are trying to chill on earth, and there are souls in trouble. See, now we talk about okay, the people take the money, right? Now think about it. Folks will go frolic and spend all the money frolicking. And come to church, I ain't got no money. Wait a minute, you just went to Atlanta for the weekend and spent a few $100s. But you come to church and you put some change in the church offering. But then you go start telling me, I love Jesus. Hold on. You went and got a hotel room. You paid gas. If you rented a car, you paid that. Whatever. All this that you spent to, and I'm just talking about driving. Forget about getting a flight. All that money you spent because you needed a break, right? Mm-hmm. But then you turn around and say, I will serve the God of peace. If he is the God of peace,
hallelujah,
and his word says, I will keep them in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on me because he trusts in me,
indeed,
right? Mm-hmm. Then why do I then need to stop doing God's work to go and take care of some carnal business?
Come on.
Y'all follow me? So here we are. We have two problems because, you know, we used to have pastors in the church who did disappear. Now they'll take a month off. I need a break. Now, if a church member came to me and said, Pastor, I'm going to take a month off. I need a break. I know I'd have a problem with that. Okay. For one, if you love them, you know their soul's in trouble. Because if you think that you can disconnect from God for a month and you're going to stay saved, you got another thing coming. I was disconnected for 3 months from the church, but I was disconnected because I was in hospital. I was confined to the hospital. But you know how painful it was to miss one service?
Yes.
And every time I missed one, it hurt more and more. I was so desperate to get to God's house, you know. And we, you know, come and have church in the hospital room and all that. It was my residence for 3 months. You know, but there's nothing like being in the house of God with the
people of God.
You understand? So now we've gotten our priorities confused. And again, the subject tonight is the imploding church. The church is falling in because from the top there's too much sin weight from the head. The Bible says like people like priests. So the people follow the pastor. So if you see me half stepping, know what you're going to do? Yes. And especially since evil communication corrupts good manners. So if I begin to communicate to you an evil, ungodly, unrighteous lifestyle, then what did you learn? You understand? So, you know, you look at what's going on in churches, and the reason the churches have been rendered so powerless. Now, we got plenty of entertainment. You know, the music real good and everybody jumping and all that stuff. But there's no authority. There's no power. There's no change. But there's a whole lot of commotion. A whole lot of noise. And you know, ain't nothing wrong with the music. Nothing wrong with the dancing. Nothing wrong with any of it other than the fact that it's entertainment and it's not worship. When it was worship, we didn't have music, didn't need music. The Holy Ghost moved you. Whether you had the drum beating, whether you had the washboard or whatever, you had the tambourine, whatever, if you didn't have any of that, the Holy Ghost moved you. Today, this is how you know the Holy Ghost is not moving, because as soon as the music starts, everybody sits down. So you know it's no Holy Ghost. When the Holy Ghost gets you and the music stops, You're not dancing because of the music. You're dancing in the Holy Ghost.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
I care about no music. I don't need music. What was that? Sunday? Saturday or Sunday?
when everybody started dancing and no music was playing, right? Nobody was on the keyboard, right? When the Holy Ghost broke out, the dance broke out. There was no music going on. But just the Holy Ghost, when the Holy Ghost shows up, something happens. You don't need a beat. You don't need a tune. You don't need a chord. The Holy Ghost shows up and something happens. But now, when the church begins to implode, then our motivation is external. So I need you to do something to get me motivated. Man, when you have the Holy Ghost on, for real, deep down, when you have the Holy Ghost, ain't nobody to charge you. Ain't nobody. You ain't got to get me motivated.
That's right.
But there's something about what you say from your mouth, from the Holy Ghost, that'll move me. But not because you had to tell me, come on, come on. But you said something. You reminded me of how good God is. And there was a witness on the inside that wants to worship. Now, this is how you know the difference between the Holy Ghost and entertainment. When people are really saved, they love to connect with saved people.
That's right. Amen.
Tell you what I said. Yeah. I don't fellowship with everybody. Because everybody's not saved. There was a time when the sanctified church was respected because we didn't fellowship with Baptists. We didn't fellowship with Methodists and all those other people. Because their doctrine is anti-Christ. Yeah. Their doctrine is ungodly. You cannot be saved in a doctrine that is inconsistent with the Word of God. So if you don't believe in holiness from the beginning, nothing we can do. We can't. How can two walk together except they be coming to them? Okay? So you cannot walk together except you be agreed. Now, a little leaven, leaveneth the whole lump. So what has happened is that now we've hooked up with any and everybody. We used to not be afraid to say Baptist folk need the Holy Ghost. Methodists need the Holy Ghost. Now we're afraid to say, we say stuff like this. Oh, people saved everywhere. That's a lie. They are not. You cannot be saved in a damnable doctrine. If you receive the Holy Ghost, you won't stay there. You can receive the Holy Ghost in prison. You can receive the Holy Ghost anywhere. But you're not going to stay there. Yeah, you're not going to stay there. No. Because light hath no fellowship
with darkness.
There's no way. But now we've gotten to church now because it's my friend, because it's my family, because of this and that connections, because they bring good money, and so we invite them all in. You can keep your money.
All right, come on.
Mm-hmm. I'll take Jesus. He supplies all of our needs.
Thank you, Jesus.
Now this is the condition of the church. And what I always tell y'all, when you see Pastor Gang changing, you need to come help me, right?
Yes.
Because I promise the Lord and y'all, I'll never change. Not promise that?
Amen.
Huh? Amen. That's my proclamation. I never change. If the Bible says it, I'm all for it.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
A little leaven.
Leaven the whole.
A little leaven.
Leaven the whole.
So you can't fool with any of it. Come on. And so here's the thought. If we start to honestly examine what harm our teachings are doing, what harm our preachments are doing, our lifestyles, our behaviors, our habits, our goings on, our dress, everything that comes from us, and we look at the effect that all of those things are having on the church and on the world at large, the question is God going to hold us accountable for violating some stuff? They're looking at me, and when the devil looks at the saints, those who say they're saints, and is comfortable and complimentary of you, you better start checking your salvation.
That's right.
The devil cannot be comfortable around God. He just can't do it. He just can't do it. If the devil is comfortable around you and is not changing, now, some unsaved will come, want to be around because they want to be saved. And they're comfortable in the knowledge that you're saved. And if I hang around with you, I'm going to go that direction you're going. That's where I want to go. That's a good hookup. But they're coming your way. But when they're willing to just hang around you and never change, if your unsaved family just hang around you and cut the food, smoke, drink, cuss, all of that, they've shown you they have no respect for you. Now, the question to ask yourself is, why do they why do they not have any respect for me? You understand?
Amen.
The imploding church. So we take all of these faults that we have and we bring them into the church house and say we're doing God's business, but there are never any results. How many people these days come to church and testify that I'm saved and turn right around and go back to life and say, now think about that. How many people have you seen in church? They come through the church. Oh, I received the Holy Ghost. I'm saved. And ooh, I'm going to live right. And turn right around. And everything that they were doing, they go back to doing it. Right away. Right away. Go back to doing it. Oh, because back in the ignorant church, we said, Jesus. We did tarry service. Now, don't take all that. You ain't got to tarry. I'll go with the Bible. Well, the Bible doesn't say it's a sin to go Jesus. The day they call the name of the Lord shall be
saved.
But those ignorant preachers knew what they were doing.
Come on.
They understood that when you really want it, you ask for it. Mm-hmm. Right? The woman before the unjust judge.
Yes.
She worried that man to death, didn't she? Mm-hmm. Now this judge was unjust.
Yes.
But every time you see it, she back. I want my stuff. So he gave her stuff. Now Jesus said, now how much more, you know, will God do for you, right? Mm-hmm. If you're persistent. So in our persistence, tarry, Jesus. What are you saying? Save me, Lord.
Yes, Jesus.
And the whole point is save me, Lord. Jesus. You really want to know what you want. Yeah. And you know how long it takes for you to actually get to the place where you allow yourself to decrease so the Holy Ghost take over? Right? So the whole point of tarry service is that you have to get to the place where mentally, spiritually, you become, you yield. So you can receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Because he doesn't fill you against your will. But your will has to be there. And if you've not gotten to the place where you really want to receive the gift, he can't give it to you. You can't receive something you don't really want. So that's why we always had Jesus. And if you ever tarry, I'm talking about, you get to the place, you get so desperate, Jesus. If you don't save me, I'm going to come to heaven and take it from you. Jesus. Because you're desperate. Well, the Holy Ghost. Then what happens is he fills you with the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Now back then, folks received the Holy Ghost and they laid on their backs and spoke in tongues.
Yeah.
For a long time. I'm saved now. That, no microwave stuff. See, now those people, some were still living, lived holy. There was a difference between the saint and the sinner. Today they come in, cry a little bit, maybe snot, speak in their tongue, then they get up and want to instruct the church. Well, that's not the Holy Ghost. When you receive the Holy Ghost, you don't go into the mold and I got to tell y'all how to live. When you receive the Holy Ghost, you're so grateful for receiving the Holy Ghost, you got praise in your mouth. Yeah. Today, there's no praise. They say I received the Holy Ghost last night. They come back tonight, they want to preach. Mm-hmm. They want to tell everybody else what y'all need to do, what y'all not doing. Wait a minute. Hold on. If you just receive this gift, man, and you're finished, thank you, Jesus, for the Holy Ghost. What? Is there a greater gift than the Holy Ghost?
Yes.
Oh, my word. When you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, it's this, you're talking about the Big Bang Theory, it's a whole nother place. Woo! And when you've been tarrying, you know, you say, it was that easy?
Yeah.
All that tarrying I did, I could have just received. Right, but that's the reason you were tarrying. You got to the place where you decreased, right? So now we really received the Holy Ghost. But today we don't have the same church. And people talk about, you know, well, it's not, no, it's not the age. It's not the age. God didn't change. We changed. If the church does what, if my people, this is the promise of God. If my people do what I say, they're protected. Period. I don't care what changes happen in the quote unquote church world, man's church world. If we stand on the word of God, if we walk in this, the promises of God, in him they are yea, in him they are amen. We're sealed in that. Our problem is that we've allowed the little leaven to come into the church, and now it's leavened the whole lump. Y'all understand? Now, you know, people think I'm mean or whatever. I don't fellowship with Baptist people. I don't fellowship with Methodist people. there's nothing a Baptist preacher can preach to me because he needs the Holy Ghost. If you don't have the Holy Ghost, you can't preach to me.
That's right.
How can they preach except they be sent? God only sends holy vessels to preach to holy vessels. He only sends holy vessels to preach to unholy vessels who want to be holy. But he will also send an unholy vessel to preach to vessels who don't want to be holy. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. God gives us pastors according to his heart. Not after his heart. It's always misquoted. And if you misquote it, you misunderstand it. He does not give pastors after his heart, according to his heart. It is God's decision to give the pastors he wills to give. Understand?
Amen.
So you have some people who will never really, who will never want to walk in holiness, but they're only church. So God sets them up with the leadership they will. The leadership they want is the pastor who lets them do any and everything. You can shack, you can smoke, you can do everything the world does and still come and we anoint you as saved. So he gives them that leadership. That's why we have gay churches. Pastor's gay, everybody, oh, so comfortable. See, when the church says, oh, no one judges you here, that's not a God's church.
Come on.
Because judgment begins. So that's not God's church. So again, the imploding church. So we wonder why we are where we are. But we are to stand fast, therefore, in the liberty which Christ has made us free. And we're not to be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. We're not to no longer run in sin. We have to look at my lifestyle. How is it affecting the church? Me as the pastor, how is my teaching, how is my living affecting you? Look at how your lifestyle, when you say you're saved, how it's affecting your family members. Can your family respect you? Or are they saying, well, you say you're saved, but you don't everything to death. I mean, you know, they'll talk about you when you're saved and try to make you feel bad. I ain't talking about that. All right. But when they have concrete, you know, evidence that your lifestyle is ungodly, there's a problem. Ought not be. Well, if that's what being saved is, you cuss like I cuss. You smoke like I smoke.
Come on. Yes.
You commit fornication like I commit fornication. You run around like I run around. What's the difference?
No difference.
Yeah. When we were sanctified, folks knew you were sanctified. When sanctified folks walked around, everybody, oh, they sanctified. Oh, they sanctified. Back in the day, when the sanctified preacher came out, the smokers would hide their cigarettes. They'd hide their alcohol. They didn't want the man of God to see them, the woman of God to see them with that stuff. How you doing? They saved y'all. Put it away. Today, it'll be over. That's what they'll do. See? Now the problem is they've seen so many crooked, ungodly church people until most of the world has lost respect for church. But still, when you stand on the integrity of the Holy Ghost, they know the difference. Mm-hmm. When I walk over here to this yard, they know the difference. Mm-hmm. They know the difference. They know the difference. I see some, you know, their preachers, you know, some of these preachers, they do what they do. Don't do what you do. You know, you have to be holy still. You can't straddle the fence, as we say. See, so you're going to have to stand on holiness.
Yes.
Now, remember now, God can't change, right? Paul writes in Titus 1 and 2 that God who cannot lie. He can't change. He cannot lie. So who's doing the changing? And who's doing the lying? So it's the perpetual deception of man that constantly serves as the deal breaker, as man would say, the deal breaker. Man's misbehaviors separate us from the promises of God. Regardless of the will of God, he cannot extend his blessings beyond man's lack of commitment to righteousness. We are not committed to righteousness, so God can't bless us. You understand? We're not committed to righteousness. So how is God going to bless you when you won't bless him?
Amen.
If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I bless them. Otherwise, I can't do it. Y'all understand?
Amen.
So, regardless of his will, God can't extend his blessings beyond your commitment or the lack of absence of commitment on your part. Now, many people today confuse God's grace and God's mercy with his justice. Oh, we got this thing now where God's unconditional love. There is no such thing as God's unconditional love. There is no Bible for that. It ended at the cross. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that the condition, whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That was unconditional. It stopped right there. It stopped there. Now all souls belong to God, but the soul that sinneth,
it shall die.
So if his love is unconditional, then no one's ever going to go to hell, because his love comes with no conditions, right?
Come on.
Mm-hmm. You ever hear people say, oh, I love them unconditionally? You cannot love anyone unconditionally. It's impossible for me to love you unconditionally. It's impossible. We don't have the ability to love unconditionally. It's impossible. I love you intensely, but not unconditionally. That is, to love unconditionally is a myth, okay? God's love towards us comes with conditions. It comes with requirements. Be holy, for I am holy. If it were not necessary to be holy, then God would have never instructed us to be
holy.
So now, by virtue of his instruction to us to be holy, there must be conditions. If there were no conditions, then what would be the point of being holy? Understand? So when you run with any and everybody, a little leaven is the whole lump. Everybody's belief. Y'all know this morning you ate some Chinese food, and 2 hours later you ate some Greek food. Then you went a few hours later, they got some Mexican food, right? Mm-hmm. Know what you're going to be? You can't eat everything. You can't keep mixing all this stuff. There's only one way to hear from God. That's through his word. If what comes out of my mouth contradicts this Bible, then you are not hearing from God through me. Let's get that straight. I don't care how dogmatic I am. I don't care how forcefully I express it. If it contradicts this Bible, and I don't care how charismatic, I don't care. God, I can even say God told me. But if it contradicts what's written in here, God didn't move me, God didn't show me, God didn't tell me, God didn't speak. Understand? We're living in a day now where everyone, now think about it, in the church, when we say God's speaking, if God gives me the gift of tongues, and I speak in tongues, right? Or no, you have the gift of tongues, and I have the gift of interpreting tongues. So when you speak, I'm going to interpret the tongues. Said the Lord. God does not speak like that.
No.
Because God is not an entertainer. Listen now. God doesn't have to speak through emotion. He doesn't have to speak through antics. God speaks very soberly. It's sober. When God communicates, it's so clear that the least intellectually endowed or the least academically prepared of us can understand what God says. So there's nothing to figure out, because God speaks very succinctly, very clearly, for everyone to understand. And so if God tells me to tell you, I don't have to stand you up and make a big production. I don't have to say, thus saith the Lord. I don't have to speak in a tongue. I don't have to get emotional. When God tells me to speak, I speak. Period. Then if the spirit moves on me, quickens me where I'm communicating it and I get emotion and all of that, it's still going to come to pass. The problem is that we're drunken on the emotion. I've been in church many times and people start speaking in tongues. And Lord, while they're speaking, if it's you know, music going on, there's noise, they're speaking. Let the music stop, let the noise stop, they're speaking, they get real loud. Thus saith the Lord, God said, do this. Thus saith the Lord, stop. Stop. God doesn't have to perform to speak. He's sober and is speaking.
Amen.
So if God can speak so all can understand, then it's not in the entertainment. It's in the truth. God told me to tell y'all tonight that in 3 days, a bomb's going to go off in Washington, D.C. What's today?
Today.
Okay. 3 days. Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, if I tell y'all God said a bomb go off today, and we get to Saturday, and no bomb went off, I don't care how I said it. Oh, God said it's going to blow up. It's going to blow up. It's going. I don't care how I do it. If in 3 days that bomb doesn't explode, I lied.
Yes, that's right.
I lied. If we get to Saturday and there's not been an explosion, it wasn't the truth. But then y'all afraid to come and say, excuse me, preacher man, you said 3 days. We're at day five, because it'll be Sunday. We're at day five. No explosion. Now, we're afraid to hold people accountable for telling lies, right? All the working up I did, nothing. Now, this, you know, the church is imploding. All this I did, I went through all that. I stood before y'all and spoke in a tongue and... Oh, and God said, and you know, I can see it in 3 days. 3 days, you're going to get a new car. And 30 days later, you know, you still don't have your car. Then I come back then and tell you again, God said keys. I see God give you a new house. And you still give me some more money and go crazy, lose your mind, jumping. 2 years later, you don't have your house. But there's no accountability. We keep going back to that mess. You have no obligation to honor an unholy spirit that sits before you as a leader. None at all. Because God does not ordain evil leaders to lead righteous people. But he does ordain evil spirits, evil leaders to lead evil people. That's another lesson about for that too. He'll put evil leadership in place for disobedient people. You will, now God cannot punish you at the hands of the righteous, because the hands of the righteous are clean. So he will give you he will take the hands of the unrighteous to dish out the punishment. Understand? But he'll never do it through the righteous. And there are some people, again, they're not gonna leave the church, they just don't want Jesus. A lot of folk love, you know, people love to talk about what God said. Everybody today is God told me. Everybody stand in church. God told me to tell y'all. God said. God showed me. Ain't none of it coming to pass. And then my thing is always, if God speaks to you so much, why is your life so jacked up? All that talking God does, every time you open your mouth, God said, but then look at your life and your life is a mess. God, you got some jokes, man. You can tell me, you can give me all the information about everybody else, but you can't give me anything to help me. That's cuckoo. So it is imploding because we've walked away from the order of righteousness in the church. When we were not obsessed with what people thought, when someone comes through these doors, I can't worry about how they feel about God. My responsibility is to teach and preach this word.
That's right.
How I can't make you receive it. All I can do is give it to you. Now think about this. Jesus came, right? And they killed him. Here God comes in the flesh to die for all of us. And man turns around and kills him. But the same people who crucified him, he died for them. And if they repented of what they did, they were saved. So even after you crucified him on the cross, you the one who pierced him in the side had a chance to repent and receive the Holy Ghost.
Sure did.
And to live eternally with the one he crucified on the cross.
Yes.
That's what God did for us. So they didn't all receive Jesus. They didn't receive Apostle Paul. We talk, oh, he's the greatest of the apostles. You know, we have most of what we know about living holy comes from Paul. From his writings. They didn't receive Paul. So if they don't receive you, what you mad about? Well, I disagree. Well, I ain't mad at you. We disagree. You don't have to agree with me. Well, now, but if you can take the Bible and show me where I'm wrong, I'm happy to listen to you. But if you can't take this word and disprove what I've shown you, then you better talk to God about that. I'm not the one, but I'm not mad with you because you don't agree, because you don't believe it. There is no conflict. He told me to preach the word. He didn't say make them agree with you. He didn't say get angry if they don't agree. He said preach the word, be instant in season. Now today is out of season. Now he also says reprove, rebuke, exhort. With all. So all this attitude in the church, well, you don't accept that. Long suffering.
Yes.
I preached to you, you didn't do right. Long suffering. I'm not going to blast you because I'm going to keep preaching to you. Mm-hmm. All long suffering and doctrine. But I'm going to reprove and rebuke. Mm-hmm. I'm going to give you the doctrine. But it has to be long suffering. So if you don't, it's not my church, God's church.
That's right.
My job is to tell you the truth. If you don't listen to me, that's okay. You just keep coming. Because I promise you, none of us can ignore this word. You can hear this word. Hearing comes by the word of
God.
There's no way in the world you can hang around this word and not start hearing.
That's right.
It starts making sense. Oh, Lord, the word of God is doing something to me. I don't know what's going to happen. Yep, it's called the word, baby. You can't out-talk God. You can't out-talk him, right?
Amen.
Think you can? If you can, you're bad. You're also crazy. But you can't outdo God. God's got the answer. See? And so, if we take the word for what it really means, listen, we are to be wedded to the righteousness of God. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. Well, why don't you go? Because, baby, a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. Understand? That's why, I don't go out on dates. Mm-mm. Because I go on a date, I'm saying,
yeah.
I understand.
Yeah.
Remember back in the day, not even being saved, just back in the day when the world had standards, when a young woman went out on a date with a man, they were escorted. Because everybody from the beginning of time knew what that meant. Male, female, trouble. Mm-hmm. So don't do it. Somebody's got to be with us.
Amen. Amen.
Otherwise, something's going to be happening.
Yep.
Somebody's got to be with us.
That's right.
Or it's going down, as they say.
Right.
Right? Because a little leaven.
Leaven,
well, we just holding hands. Well, shut the lights off. See what happens. A little leaven, baby. Leave the hands alone.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, it's just a little pet. Leave it alone. Leave it a little leaven. Leaven the whole lump. Well, ain't no harm. Hey! There's harm. This harm. Now, you know, wholesome women want to be respected by a man.
That's right.
These days, we let the man get all of the nookie, and then he go bye-bye. He going to test the milk, and say, I got the milk, why I need to get the cow for? So he goes bye-bye, right? Mm-hmm. Now, understand this, let me explain this to y'all. Because I think sometimes what happens, you got to hear the whole story. Sometimes you hear and you make yourself lower than you really are. You see what I'm saying? You're exposed to what you're exposed to. You know what you know, right? Your experiences shape you. And not just your personal experience as in what you do, but there are things that are done around you. A child who grows up in a home where everybody cuss, a child's probably going to cuss at a young age. Just the way it is. That's what they're around. Right? Child goes in the home where everybody getting high. They're going to be getting high. They're getting high anyway. If you're in there, they're getting high. Guess what?
Contact.
So it's just the way it is.
their realities. But again, a little leaven, leaveneth the whole. So what you are the old saying, you are what you eat, right? It, your environment, your surroundings influence you. So some, there are a lot of things that, that people do, and it's not because they're bad people. You're doing what you know. The issue is when you learn better, you do better. Sometimes people just don't know. No one ever told you how to dress, how to cover up your flesh. Because, see, if you listen to a man would say he's looking for, you know, a man. When I wasn't saved, I was looking for everything I could see. Well, I wasn't trying to be saved or married. I wanted to see what I wanted to see. It was exciting to see what I wanted to see. So when I saw her, she got the attention, because I ain't had no good intentions. See? But then when you talking about getting serious, you want a wifey, well, you don't go get the trick, you go get the treat. Y'all understand?
Amen.
So you want a party, you go to the club. And get the club during the party. But when you want a wife, you're not gonna find her at the club. My wife's not at the club. She ain't out partying. No, my wife's a lady. She's not that worried about it. Got the hands on her and all this stuff, and she's showing all her stuff, and she walking around all her stuff. Nah, that's not mine, man. I don't need you knowing my stuff. That's somebody else's. I don't know. Y'all can have that. See? Now, the church used to be like that, where women came to church and their flesh was covered.
Amen.
Now you go to church. Man, they got stuff showing. I tell you what, sometimes they just give me a roll of ones. And just let it rain. Just let it rain. Cause Lord, they look like hookers in here. Woo-hoo, just throw the money out. Girl, go ahead and shake for me. Then they get, and then the music start going to church. They start dancing. You got your stuff tight. It's this right, all this out. And there, all this up to here. And you up shaking everything, going everywhere. You just got stuff about to pop out. Hey, put that away.
It's the truth. Come on.
It's the truth.
A little light. So then, young man come to church, thinks he want to be saved. Mm-hmm. But by the time he come, all the women running around and all this stuff hanging out, they got everything jumping. They want to put on a girdle. So you got everything just flapping, flapping, everything just flapping, flapping, flapping. Man, I went to see Jesus and I saw the strip club.
Okay.
Well, you got distracted.
Mm-hmm.
You got distracted.
Yep.
It ought to be the case where we come to church, right? I'm saved. So if I say I'm saved, my lifestyle ought not be tempting to anyone.
That's right, man.
Ought not wear anything where some woman is gonna have a problem. Ooh, no, I have to cover myself up.
That's right.
Problem. I can't wear it tight because I don't need any woman seeing the form of my body. All that is my wife's business.
That's right.
Amen. I understand.
Amen.
And then the moment I say to you, well, that you ought not be looking, well, I'm the devil.
Mm-hmm.
Because if meat causes my brother to offend,
I won't eat.
If it offends you, I can't wear it.
You cannot.
Y'all hear me? No, you can't wear that. That's why I like to preach in the robe. I don't need to make a move in it. Cover it up. Cover it up. Otherwise, somebody could possibly. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to be responsible for that, right? So you're always thinking about how your lifestyle affects other people.
Yeah.
Want to make sure what I say, what I do, what I wear, where I go, all of that has to be holy. I don't even go to gospel concerts and stuff. I don't, because I don't play church. And most people doing that stuff, they're playing church. They go there and they dancing, get out, and they trying to get the hook up, go out, they act the fool, call that, playing all that stuff. I don't do that. I don't want to be defined. I don't get identified with those people. That's not what I do. I don't live that lifestyle. I don't come to church and we have a good time, and then you see me out there and I'm cutting the food.
Mm-hmm.
Go to the restaurant and I'm in there acting like a fool and all this stuff and trying to get a number, you know, trying to get some hookup and all that. No, I'm not with those people. So I can't fool with most preachers because I don't run women. A little leaven. So what happens is you begin to be identified by the people you associate with.
Mm-hmm.
Man, you hang out with them. Something wrong with you. If you're a lady and you hang out with a whore, are they gonna say you are? If you're a gentleman and you hang out with a whore, they're gonna say, oh, he just like him. Because the same birds of a feather flock together. The little leaven we've allowed to come into the church is destroying. The church is Imploding. Let me move on. All right, so now let's go to Matthew chapter 25. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory, and before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on his left. So, the idea of, you know, God's unconditional love, okay, is a myth. Goats, sheep. Goats to the left, sheep to the right. The goats didn't meet the condition, okay? Jesus told Nicodemus, except the man be born again of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That's a condition, right? Except you be born again of water and of the Spirit. Otherwise, you can't make it to the kingdom. And if you are born again, then your old lifestyle is in the past. Old things are passed away. All things are become new. The old man is crucified with his deeds. So the things I used to do when I wasn't saved, I don't do those things anymore. If I still do those things, then I'm not saved. Right? A saved person lives a saved person's lifestyle. Right? You're supposed to be what you say you are. You tell me, oh, I'm a policeman, but every time I see you, you know, you got a fireman suit on. Wait a minute, excuse me. Are you a policeman or a fireman? I'm a policeman. But every time I see you, you dress like a fireman. Somebody's confused. I ain't that dumb. I look like it, but I'm not really that dumb. You're a fireman. You're a fireman. Man, I saw you fighting the fire. You had the fireman's uniform on, you're fighting the fire, but you insist that you are a policeman. So you're crazy. Mm-hmm. I'm not. I'm saying, well, you dress like a whore. You dress like a pimp. Every time I see you, got all your stuff hanging out. Supposed to be a saved man, you got body shirt on, tight stuff. You got show your muscles, show all of this. You supposed to be a man of God. And you're dressing, trying to tempt a woman. That's no man of God. You're a trick.
Right.
A man of God dresses appropriately. We believe in modest apparel, not because of what our church rules are. It's because the Bible says, yes. Modesty. Y'all understand?
Amen.
So when everything's hanging out, there's a problem. If it's hanging out, it isn't modest. You got some schools, when the girls go to school and the stuff, it can be too short or too revealing, they'll send them home from school.
Yeah.
You come to church half naked, the preacher sit there like, ooh, this is a good service. He is loving what he's seeing. You can sit on the front seat. Everything's shown. And he has no issue. No issue. None. Now, we don't send them home. Put Jesus in them. Don't send them home. They got to get the word. They shouldn't send them from school. Need to be a school learner, quite frankly. But it's another story. But no, we don't send them out. We don't put them out. Put Jesus in. Understand? But how are you going to change when no one ever shows you righteousness?
Right.
How are you going to be righteous and no one ever shows you, teaches you righteousness?
That's
so we don't have righteous teaching in today's church. Most of us talking about money. Most of us talking about money. You know, now think about it. If there are so many preachers who I know will tell the people, will blast the people because they didn't pay their tithes. Right? And they tell you cursed. That's why you can't be blessed. You're not a tither. So you walk away feeling, Lord, you ain't gonna get nothing because I didn't pay my tithe. And they'll call you on the carpet for not giving your money. But you can be the biggest devil in the church. You can be gay, lesbian, you can be a whoremonger, and they'll go, don't, that's all right, that's God's business. Wait a minute, hold on, preacher, time out. Now you got a Bible for the works of the flesh. Got a Bible for that. And if you do these things, you can't enter heaven. Got a Bible for that. But you say, well, you know, that ain't got nothing to do with that. But you have a Bible for that. They that do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. If you don't inherit the kingdom of God, what you going to inherit? Okay? That's raw Bible, right? This is real simple. Now, you don't have any Bible that says if you don't pay tithes, you're going to hell. There's nothing in this Bible that says you're going to go to hell if you don't pay tithes. Nothing. but it's a common message in the church. If you don't pay tithes, you're going to hell. No, if you don't pay tithes, if you said that you're going to tithe and you stop tithing, you are a liar.
Amen.
You're not going to hell because you don't pay tithes. You're going to hell because you're a liar. That's why you're going to hell, because you made a vow and you broke your
vow.
So if you broke your vow, you are now a
liar.
You understand?
Amen.
But why am I going to beat you about money? But when it comes to your lifestyle, well, can't judge them. Wait a minute. On Sunday morning, they'll read the list of tithers. Read the list of tithers. So-and-so, and this one, and that one, there's a tithe list. Your name on the hall, they've got the list in the church of all the folks who pay tithes. They got them listed. Well, put the name of the folks who are hypocrites.
All right. Come on.
Come on.
Shouldn't put anybody's name anywhere. But I'm just saying,
yeah.
I know this. I can't go to this Bible and tell you, well, you're going to hell because you never pay tithes. Mm-hmm. But I can say, you lied about tithing, Ananias and
Sapphira.
So you're going to give up the ghost. Now that, I got money for that. Mm-hmm. But not because you didn't pay tithes, because you're like, well, it was yours. It was for you to do what you wanted to do with it, right? But when you said the first time you paid a tithe, know what you did? You entered a covenant.
You sure did.
Yeah. The first time you gave me $10,000, right? And it was a gentleman's agreement. But then I made a payment to you of $500. Then I stopped. And we have a receipt. You gave me $500. So then we go to court and I say, well, I didn't borrow anything. I said, yes, you did. You borrowed $10,000. No, I didn't. Well, you made the first payment. Mm-hmm. Well, but it wasn't, actually it was an agreement. Why did you make the payment? Well, you didn't give $500 out of the goodness of your heart. Stop playing. Understand? So now how can you prove that you gave them $10,000? Well, Your Honor, here in my account this day, $10,000 withdrawal, and the reason I took out $10,000 was to give to them. So they started, well, it was a gift. Wait a minute, but you paid me back. You started paying me back. So you entered into an agreement to repay the loan.
Yes.
See what I'm saying? So if you make your case, and you with God, you got to do all that because it's real simple. You mean for God. So you said God gave you your job, right?
Mm-hmm.
Don't we say that when we get a job? Thank God he blessed me with a new job. Isn't it amazing how God bless you with a new job? Folks, tell my God bless me with a job last week and this week to my, I can't stand that job. I want another job. Yeah. Y'all pray for me, I get another job. Wait a minute. You said if God gave you that job, then you've been there a month and now you're ready to go. God, give me another job. So did God give you that job?
No.
Okay. But you say God gave me the job, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you start, I'm going to pay my tithes. And you pay them the first time, maybe second time. But then you stop paying. So, you know, it's okay. You don't have to pay tithes. But you just have to keep your word. So now you're a liar. So now you're in trouble. So the way you do is correct your lie, right?
Amen.
Return. Do your first works
over.
Understand?
Amen.
If you do that, then you won't be in so much trouble. The problem is that the church is so focused on the wrong thing. When we used to come to church and we were focused on souls being saved, people were healed.
Yeah.
People were delivered. They were healed. I don't see too many healings in the church. To where I know for a fact that Jesus heals. When you have witnessed people in the church, or not just in church, but being prayed for, and on the spot when you see swelling goes down right in your face, right before your eyes, it goes. When you see a stroke, the twitch of the face right before your eyes, when the preacher prays and the face straightens up right there when you're looking at them, it all just straightens up. Whoa. You ain't like that no more? It's like this. You know Jesus heals.
Come on. Yes.
But we keep talking about those things that happened back then. in the not so much even in the 80s and the 60s and 70s where it happened so mightily back then. But God didn't change. What happened was the sanctified church changed its focus. We used to be called holy rollers and Jesus freaks. And we know that was a compliment. Now you're just like everybody else. It's all about the Benjamins, all about the dollars. Get the money, get the money, get the money. Everything about the money. Well, you know, you got to make sure they stay there because if you don't have money, you can't pay the bills. Oh, really? Is your faith in the people or in God?
All right.
Come on.
Yes.
I don't care who leaves here. I don't care who doesn't come. God provides.
Come on.
Yeah. He does.
So I never have to cater to anybody because I cater to Jesus.
Yes.
The one who can hold, the only one who can hold me accountable for my soul, right?
Uh-huh.
So the wisdom of freeing yourself from people is, please God, Lord, I'm gonna do what you say. Yeah. So I'm not offended when people say, "Oh, Candy, you're so hard, you're so strict, you're so this or that." Whatever. That doesn't faze me. Jesus is holy. Mm-hmm. Holy is not strict. Holy is not hard. Holy is not difficult. Holy is joyous. It's so great to be just holy. You just stay in God's will. You don't go to bed at night worried about nothing. Worry about if I die, Lord, where am I going to go? I'm holy.
Amen.
Holy.
Y'all understand?
Yes, Lord.
When you live a lifestyle where no one can come, they can criticize you, but not factually concerning sin.
Yeah.
They can disagree with you, but you can't mark my life.
Come on.
That's holy. I'm doing the thing now. See?
Yes.
If our problem is that because we're so unholy, when people say, criticize, and they're correct, it makes you real mad.
Yeah.
Makes you real, I thought you were saved. I am saved. Well, what? God freed me. We've been enlightened.
Yeah.
Enlightenment's killing the church.
Yes.
It's imploding. And we were blind, and when you're blind, you walk by
faith.
When you become enlightened, you start walking by sight. Now you look just like the world. You dress like the world. You walk like the world. You talk like the world. You act like the world. What's the difference?
No difference.
What's the difference?
Not a difference.
If we're going deep on y'all. All right? You know, y'all know I get deep every now and again, right? It's been a while, so I'm gonna go deep tonight.
Okay.
You follow me? Okay. Here's the deep one. If it isn't different, it's the same. I know that was deep. But I promise y'all, if it isn't different, it's the same. It was that deep. Okay, you know, it's been a while since I've been deep. If it isn't different, y'all, it's the same. And if it's the same, when you said it was unholy, and now you say it's holy, but it's the same, well, then it can't be holy. Because none of us were born saved. None of us were born saved. So the old man was filthy, right? I didn't smoke, me neither, but I was still filthy.
Come on.
I didn't do drugs, but I was still filthy.
Come on.
Because sin is
filthy.
Y'all understand? So we get caught up in God's grace. God's grace, God's unmerited favor. Isn't that great? Right? His unmerited favor. Well, and favor is an act of kindness beyond what you really have earned or you deserve. Okay, so we look at God's grace, His unmerited favor, and we look at His mercy, okay, and compassion, His forgiveness that He shows towards that you show towards someone whom you can demonstrate or exercise judgment over, but your compassion says, "Don't do it," right? But then we forget about God's justice. So we look at His grace, and His grace is when we're receiving blessings that we don't deserve, right? I don't deserve that, but God's grace, by His grace, I have it. Look at His mercy, and that's not receiving punishment that we do deserve. See how wonderful God is, His grace and His mercy. Oh, but God's justice. When He looks at you and judges you according to what you've done. So at some point, you're going to pay the price. And guess who you can't fool? You can't game. Can't fool God. Can't game God. You can't pull one over on God. You can fool me. You can fool me. Yeah. You can fool me. But you can't fool God.
You can fool people. Not everybody, but you can fool people. But you can never, ever, none of us can ever fool God. So if we think that we're going to play with God's grace and his mercy and do whatever we want because God's grace and his mercy. And when people say they're saved and this comes out of their mouth, can't no man judge me. You need the Holy Ghost. Saved folks don't say, can't nobody judge me.
Right.
No, you know what I need to be?
Judged.
Oh, I need you to see Christ.
Yeah.
I need you to look at me and judge me. I'm saved. How are you going to see Christ if you don't see Christ through those who are saved?
All right, that's right. Amen.
You can't see Christ. He's a spirit. You can't see the Holy Ghost, can you?
No.
So you see him through me. Mm-hmm. Now, when I tell you you can't judge me, then I have something to hide. When my lifestyle is holy and it's pleasing to God, then I need you to see this holy lifestyle that's pleasing to God, that's consistent with his word. When I start talking about, can't nobody judge me, ain't no man got no heaven to hell to put me in, you need the Holy Ghost.
Right.
You need the Holy Ghost. What a pleasure for somebody to look at you and say, you know what, I've been watching you. And you sure represent what that Bible says.
Yes.
Isn't that great?
Yes.
Anybody offended by that?
No.
I've been watching you. And you sure ain't acting right. Well, you can't, hold on. Slow down. I've been watching you, and I see the way you act, your attitude, you say, like that. All you do is get everybody told. You walk around all day mad, angry, get everybody told, and all this stuff. You know what I mean? You dress like that, and you say, you can't judge me, I'm not convicted by it. Well, there you go. You need the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
For one, the spirit of the Holy Ghost does not act like that.
Right.
Huh?
Yes.
Yes.
Now listen, because the fruit of the spirit is love.
Yes.
Joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. And if somebody bothers you about that, you just tell them this. Against such.
There is no law.
Ain't no harm being holy.
Yes.
You understand? So we're trying to escape by on God's grace and his mercy. And that's good. We all need it. But remember now, his justice is coming. So you're gonna stand before God. You're gonna have to give an account of your ways, right? Goats to the left, sheep to the right. What you don't want to be going is to the left. To the left is trouble. That's trouble. That's eternal damnation. All right?
Okay.
All right. So I read that in Matthew 25, right? Right?
Amen.
All right. So our problem is that we've ignored the if. And Sunday I preached about meeting the condition, satisfying the if, right? So we forget about the if. If you don't live holy, gonna pay the price.
Yeah.
I don't care what attitude you have. I don't care how much you insist there ain't nothing wrong with you and I can do what I want and I don't see it in the word. Oh, you don't see me holy. You don't be holy if I am holy. You don't think the Bible says put difference between holy and unholy, between unclean and clean. You don't think the Bible says come out from among them and be ye separate. Understand?
Mm-hmm.
Now, the carnal mind says, well, that's hard. But the Bible says the way
I'm a transgressor, that's hard.
That's the hard road is to be a transgressor.
Yes.
It's hard for me to come to church and profess one thing and go out there and live another. And then when you see me out there living, contradicting what my mouth says in here, say, I'm saved, but then wait a minute, you're saved, but you're doing what I do, and I know why you say. Then saved folks will do what I do. You know what I do. You know what that means? Because I know I'm not saved. And we're doing the same sin.
Come on.
I know I'm not saved because I know the Bible tells me I shouldn't be doing what I'm doing. But you just say you're saved. You can't judge me. Well, you judge yourself because of what you're doing. Your lifestyle tells your story. So because we're afraid to deal with all of these things, the church is imploding. It's falling in. It's falling because we're afraid to call sin, sin.
Yeah.
Because we're afraid if I call it sin, they're not going to come. They're not going to give the money. We can't get the bills paid. So, but today's church age is the church of the Laodiceans. And the word Laodicea means church, means ruled by the people. And this church is ruled by the people.
Yes.
Well, we need to do this. We need to have that, this thing, another thing, all that. Wait, hold on. When our church, because the church is not a democracy. You know that? Mm-hmm. Let's get this straight. The church, God's church is a theocracy. God runs the church. Yeah. We don't run the church.
That's right.
Understand?
Amen.
When it was truly a theocracy, God spoke to the pastor, and the pastor delivered the word, and the people followed the man of God, and it worked out. Until the man of God looked at the preachers and wanted to be like the preachers and wanted to get the stuff that the preachers had. I want to drive in a new Benz, and I want to live in a mansion, and I want to wear the finest clothes and all that. So now you become preoccupied with projecting an image to people. So you walk away from God, so now you got to manipulate the people to get the people to support your habit. You understand? So what happens, it starts falling in. Because instead of you coming here and I'm concerned about your soul, I'm concerned about you coming back. Just so you can bring somebody else. And everybody together, the more people you get, the more cha-ching you get. So now my mind is on the money. And Paul writes to Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 6, the love of money is the root of all
evil.
So the reason the church is imploding is the result of the love of
money.
When I spend more time up here talking about the money than I am talking about righteousness, we have us a problem. Mm-hmm. We'll spend a half hour taking an offering. Half hour. We need $200 more and we ain't sitting down till we get it. Either you're a man of God, you're a preacher, you ought to be giving money. Every preacher better give me $100. You ain't got $100, you shouldn't be a preacher.
Really?
Some of us actually feed people. Some of us actually take care of people. You see what I'm saying? But now I'm going to intimidate you to give your money. I didn't even intimidate you to live holy.
All right, how about that?
How about I threaten you, you better live holy. You don't live holy, I'm going to kill you. Now, if you tell the folks to live holy, you ain't got to. Oh, wait a minute! But you just spent a half hour taking the money. How much you got, y'all? Count it right. Want to get it all? It's some more in here. Count it right. How much we need? All right, we ain't sitting down yet. Look at y'all. Y'all disobedient. Then he'll tell you you're disobedient because you didn't give an offering. An offering is a free will thing. You don't have to give your offering. That's a free will. And you better have the will to give it. But you don't have to give it. Not to me. You see what I'm saying? You give it as unto
the Lord.
Now, when I teach you to give as unto
the Lord,
then you give liberally. Then you could never give enough. Because you just love giving to support the work of the Lord. Y'all follow?
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
So when we learn to uphold the righteousness of God and say, now we're going to focus on righteousness and the money of Lord have mercy, I forgot. Jesus said himself, but seek first the kingdom of God and his
righteousness.
And all these things shall be
added unto you.
Ain't that wonderful?
Come on. Yeah.
So I don't have to focus on money.
Come on.
Right?
Right.
Huh?
Amen.
I spend my time focusing on souls. I need you saved.
Jesus.
I need you healed. I need you encouraged. I need you delivered. I need you set free. Because I'm dumb enough to know this, that if you get right with God, I have no problem with you. When you show enough, receive this, you can't give enough. You're trying to find a way. When you show enough, receive this, you go sell your
plasma
for a church offering. That's when you love the Lord. You want to do the work. I don't have any money. I'm going to sell my plasma so I can have an offering. Thank God I didn't know about it. It won't happen again. But just, you know, I'm glad I didn't know, because I would have told her, no, I'm not doing that. Did it. I didn't know about it. When I found out, great. Would you do that again? Well, you ain't selling anything. Well, the Lord gonna tell you. But see, when you come in just crazy for Jesus, you'll do whatever. Because you just want to be a blessing to the house. You understand? So you teach the righteousness of God. And remember now, righteousness exalteth. But sin is a reproach to any people. So we don't want this house, and we're not going to let it implode. So we're going to stand on the standard of holiness. We're not going to go the way of the world. We're going to put difference between holy and unholy. We won't do it because that's what the world does. You understand? You understand? The imploding church is killing us. Who's gonna hold up a standard? Where's the example going to be? If I were children, when I was going to church, I knew this. When I got sick, I called on Jesus. When I got in trouble, I was taught by example at home, my daddy happened to be a pastor, but I was taught rely on Jesus. Turn to Jesus. What are we going to teach our children?
Turn to Jesus.
We should. But there's so much foolishness going on until our children, people not coming to church and learning holiness. They're learning about singing, choir, you know, good music, dance, everybody in church doing the same dance. You think that's Jesus?
No.
Everywhere you go, everybody doing the same dance.
No.
You think that's Jesus?
No.
You go to church, everybody in church speak the same tongue? The whole church had the same tongue.
Everybody had the same tongue.
Everybody had the same. It's the church tongue. None of that's Jesus. None of that's Jesus.
It's not.
None of that's Jesus. It's unpopular because when you talk about it, folks get offended. Well, who do you think you are? Oh, I'm a man of God. I ain't got no question about that. I know what the word says. Understand? Every day is dedicated to righteousness.
Yes.
I don't have a problem with that. But I can't shut my mouth because somebody wants to get you.
Come on. Yes.
There are people who want to go to church and live for God, but when they come in, they see all this worldly stuff going on and say the church is imploding because y'all are doing the same thing that the club does. Y'all dress the same way the club dresses. That's if you come to church. These days people don't go to church. But if you come, you come and you come like the world. You don't come and worship. We used to come to church, and before you get in the door, folks would jump in the high in the spirit. Happy to be, couldn't wait to get to church. Be, oh, geez, we got church tonight. Today, we don't have. Folks used to not miss church. They would call the pastor. Pastor, something's going on. Is it okay if I miss? And most often the pastor said, no, it's not okay. You got to come. But they honored the leadership because the leadership gave them something to honor. Y'all follow me?
Mm-hmm.
You know, people talk about all the children that, right? Children, this generation. But remember now, the generation raises generation is a problem. The current generation is not the way they are because of them. Who you raise, who you get.
Mm-hmm.
Wolves raise wolves. Sheep raise sheep. So when the children are acting like wolves, well, they're being raised by wolves.
Yes.
Understand?
Amen.
So back in the day, people just called. Phone, folks called the house. It's failed again. Pastor again. Is it all right if I don't come to church tonight? This thing, that thing. My daddy always told him, no, he's like, you come to church. that take care of yourself. You come to church. Yes, sir. And they come. And I don't call nobody come to church mad because he told them they couldn't miss. And he didn't tell them they couldn't miss because of money because they didn't have any. It wasn't because of money, but they didn't have any money. It's because he understood the importance of being in church for your soul's sake. Today, people don't even show up. They'll disappear. They ain't studying the pastor. I ain't calling and asking prison. In fact, they ain't say I ain't coming. They just don't show up. Well, the next time they show up, come on, y'all, come on. Whoa, wait. You don't come to church. How are you so? I come every time the door's open. And I ain't like, you come once a week or once a month, whatever. And every time you come, it's like God has done all this for you. I'm here all the time. See? So it takes the pastor to say, you sit down. Understand?
Amen.
And I tell you quick, fast, and sit down. Do that again. Don't do that. You don't come. If you don't come to Bible study, ain't nothing for you to talk about.
Yeah.
You don't come to Sunday school, what are you going to talk about? For one, you have a disobedient spirit. Because you don't come to the teaching, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't teach. The teaching is not on Sunday morning. The teaching is on Tuesday night and Sunday morning at Sunday school.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't come to the teaching, what are you going to talk about? The core of what we believe happens on Tuesday night.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Y'all follow?
Amen.
So church following that. Because we allow little leaven. Little leaven. And the little leaven is leavening the whole
lump.
And the lump is getting so big until it's choking the church. But if my people, which are called by, shall humble themselves, pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven. Heal the land.
Thank God for you. Amen. Joshua here. We just want to give God praise for you in the video. And we hope you receive what God was imparting to you in this video and this message. And we look forward to seeing your face at 2516 Halls Mill Road, Mobile, Alabama, 36606. Now listen, if you need to call Pastor Gannon, just give me a call. 251-591-6679. You can email me at pastor@truecornerstone.org, pastor@truecornerstone.org. We thank you again, and the blessing of God be upon you in Jesus' name. Amen.